Welcome to the Healthy Screen Habits Podcast. I'm Hillary Wilkinson. Whether you're starting your parenting journey with a newborn or looking to connect with your teen on technology, let's learn some new healthy screen habits together. When I talk to teachers and parents about technology, I tend to look for trends, like what are parents concerned about? What apps are becoming the most popular, etc. So when I started hearing repeated concerns from primary grade teachers about the growing number of students they were referring for speech therapy, my ears perked up. I contacted the American Speech Language Hearing Association to see if they could refer me to someone who might be able to tease apart this mystery. And what happens next was something akin to contacting your local sports authority to ask about a few Pop Warner football rules and suddenly finding yourself in a conversation with Tom Brady. My guest today is an absolute legend of speech language pathology. She's been awarded the highest honors in multiple organizations, has published and presented nationally and internationally on topics including screen time, autobiographical memory, theory of mind, adverse childhood experiences, and the language literacy relationship, just to name a few. Dr. Carol Westby has traveled the globe studying all areas of speech development, play, and more. I'm unbelievably honored to welcome to the Healthy Screen Habits podcast, Dr. Carol Westby.
Thank you so much, Hillary. I'm really pleased to be here and have this time to chat with you.
I can't wait to get into some of the meat of it all. So I shared some of your achievements in your professional work already, but I wondered if you might be interested in sharing a little bit about your career path and how you got to where you are today.
It's been a very long career. I've been a speech language pathologist for some quite a number of years, and my undergraduate degree was in liberal arts. And early after becoming a speech language pathologist, a lot of my work has been around language and literacy. Literacy was so critical to me because without literacy, I would not be where I am today. I came from an immigrant family with a mother with a third grade education. And if people had really not given me the background skills I had in literacy, I would not be here. So that's always been extremely important. And over the years, I've worked with a lot of culturally, linguistically diverse students, first in the Albany area of New York with minority children. And I've been in New Mexico for many years. And we're a minority-majority state. 70% of our population are from non-Northern European heritage. Large numbers of our children come to school speaking even the traditional native languages, as well as a lot of Spanish speakers. And so a lot of my work has been both with speech and language therapy, but also promoting literacy. I'm not a Luddite. I love technology. I got my first computer in 1980. I cannot keep track of how many I've had and even how many have around the house. And as computers came in, we began to make use of computers in our teaching and began to look at how do you teach digital literacy? Being literate with a computer is more complex than just being literate on paper. So we started looking at that. The screen time issue came up about 3.5 years ago. I decided to visit a past student of mine who was working as a speech language pathologist in a private program in Kuala Lumpur. This is a school that was run by an American special educator for children with learning problems, many of them with autism. So I went out to spend the month in Kuala Lumpur, and I told the principal, I'll help out in any way you want. And she said, oh, would you please do training for the parents on screen time?
It's so interesting to me to hear that even in Kuala Lumpur, there we're sharing a global concern of the amount of time on screens, particularly with our young children.
And so the principal asked me to do a workshop. I think she personally called the parent of every child in the school. And her concern was, she says, I think the kids are spending all their waking hours when they're not eating or with us in school, they're on their screens. We take them away from them when the parents drop them off in the morning. The parents hand them back to them as soon as they pick them up. They're not getting other kinds of interaction. So that's when I really then began looking at what does the research say about screen time. So that's how the focus on screen time began. And then after I got back to the States, I looked extensively at the research literature coming out on screens and have done numerous presentations on the topic now.
Excellent. So one of the things that you have done in your career is create the Westby play scale, which is something that most practitioners, when I realized that I was talking to Carol Westby of the Westby play scale, I kind of had my own little fangirl moment because most practitioners in early childhood development definitely know about this. And can you speak to how important is this role of play in language development?
Oh, for language to be meaningful, it has to be functional. You have to be able to communicate. Just being able to speak clearly, just having the words isn't sufficient. And you have to be able to communicate something to someone. And you have to learn, how do I do that? So you have to have interactions. And it's in those playful interactions then that you're learning how to get an idea across to someone else. What you're also learning that is equally as important is, how do I read the cues from my peers? What are they trying to convey? What are their needs? What are their wants? So developing the social communication aspects of language are really, really critical. And that's why I get concerned if I see teachers or SLPs just focusing on teaching the words, teaching the sentences without a realistic, naturalistic context.
Excellent. So for those who are not in this realm, SLP stands for speech language pathologist. When we're talking about learning to speak or communicate in a primary language, are there specific stages or what is needed for this communication development to occur?
I'm not sure that I'd say there are specific stages, but what is absolutely essential for children to learn language, they have to have face-to-face communicative interactions, particularly young children. We have lots of research information that shows children cannot learn language from a screen. They cannot even learn it just by hearing words. They have to have the face-to-face exchange. The Harvard Center on the Developing Child has a number of really excellent videos on what they call serve and return, because they're saying that's what you need in communication. Even back in the early 1990s, we thought just the kids hearing lots and lots of words, that was most important, because the literature did show that the more words that parents use during the day, the more language children had at 3 and at 5. But then as we look more carefully, it wasn't just number of words. It was the number of back and forth turns that were more important than the total number of words. Oh. So what we meet in serve and return, it's like the baby looks at you and goes, ah, and you say, oh, you're talking to mom? And he turns his head and goes, ah. And you say, oh, yes, mommy heard you. What are you trying to tell me? And he waves his arms and you say, oh, yeah, I think maybe you're getting hungry. And you have this back and forth serve and return. Babies can do that from birth.
Oh,
and that is the absolute foundation that has to be there for communication to develop.
And I love how you point out that that is not something that a screen can teach. So that whole concept of serve and return is fascinating. Now we have to take a quick break, but when we come back, I want to dive into how technology can affect this development of language and kind of continue along those trains of thought. Do you live with a teen who is tech savvy? Maybe a digital native who's the only one who can figure out how to get the playlist going in the car? Each Tuesday on the Healthy Screen Habits Instagram and Facebook pages, we spotlight Teen Tip Tuesday. These are features submitted by teens that provide helpful hacks for productivity, managing social media, and promoting intentional tech use. If you know a teen who has a helpful screen tip, we want to hear from them. Have them contact us at healthyscreenhabits.org and put teen tip in the subject line. My guest is Carol Westby. Before the break, we were talking about language development. And being board certified in child language and literacy disorders, Carol, kind of places you in this unique spot to discuss some of the concerns that surround what seem to be rising numbers of speech referrals in the primary grades. I'm talking with a lot of pre-kindergarten to, like, say, third grade teachers, and just anecdotally only, I have no complete research to back this up, but anecdotally, when they go back in their classrooms and trace it, the numbers of speech referrals seem to be on the rise since about 2016 to 2018. Now, I know from Gene Twenge's studies that the smartphone reached a tipping point in 2012 of over 50% of the United States taking ownership at that time. So when we do the backwards math of figuring out the ages of kids born in 2012 and moving forward, and you can see those speech referrals start hitting right in that window. So anecdotally, to me, recognizing confirmation bias, it would appear as though we have a smoking gun. But I am no language expert, and that's why I have you here today. Do you see technology affecting language development or speech development in today's young children?
Well, we now have several very good studies that have shown that it does, that there is a correlation between greater uses of screen time in little ones and later developmental delays. So studies looking at how much time children were on screens between 2 and 3 showed that by the time they were 5 or 6, more screen time correlated with reduced developmental scores in language, visual perceptual skills, motor skills, and emergent literacy skills, rapid processing. This is also the ability to rapidly name something was reduced. And so there was a strong correlation. There have been several studies now that have looked at that amount of screen time early on and later developmental problems. Because of our technology now, we can also get a picture on what's going on in the brain. And those studies have shown that more screen time, poorer developmental scores, less what we call white matter integrity. And we have white matter tracts that connect different parts of our brain. And there's a specific tract that runs between our auditory area of the brain that takes in the sound and the frontal lobe of our brain where we program out what we're going to talk about. Those tracts have been shown to be significantly smaller in youngsters that have had greater amounts of screen time, which is then going to slow down that language process. What we don't know with that is that a direct cause of the screens, or is it that children aren't getting talked to? Oh. And for that track to operate, we know the brain, the neurons have to be stimulated. If they're not stimulated, they're not going to continue.
Interesting. So that kind of speaks to even what role a parent's overuse of technology would have.
And when you ask about that, again, if people have looked at what happens when parents are on their cell phones, there was an excellent CBS 60 Minutes that was done about a year and a half ago looking at that. And some of the data on this shows that parents who spend more time on their phones have children that show more behavioral problems. This is a chicken and egg thing. It turns out that if children have more behavioral problems, parents retreat more to their phones. So it's two things going on. What's happening, that can be very disrupting to that serve and return. Some children, that lack of interaction can be very disruptive and becomes very frustrating. They can't get the parent's attention. They're trying to get the attention. The parent isn't reading their cues. The kids are trying to send, but the parents aren't returning. And the children then are also missing out on learning how to read social cues. That can disrupt attachment. We talk about secure attachment.
Yes, and feeling safe and seen and soothed.
Yes, and you have to have people who are responsive, people who are looking at your cues and looking at and saying, oh, are you upset or do you need, mommy needs to get you something? If they're not getting people reading those cues, they don't learn how to read them themselves. It also turns out that children who have less secure attachments have less ability to tell coherent narratives, which are the extended language. So what you start seeing is this snowballing.
Sure. Effect. Sure. It's an overlap of, you know, what starts as what I was thinking was just primarily a speech production issue, you're now talking can have long-term ramifications into even the mental health of of a person over the, you know, the continuum of their life. Because if they're unable to form emotional attachment with another person, then it starts leading us down the path of loneliness studies, which we have made tremendous leaps into knowing about how loneliness can be as detrimental to someone's health as, say, smoking a pack of cigarettes a day. So
yeah, I'm just finishing off these couple of days a chapter on social neuroscience and was reading a recent Norwegian study where they were finding that the children who had more screens had less empathy and could not read people's faces as easily. And then that disrupts your ability to interact with your peers.
Yes. And I, there's a book written by Michelle Borba, I'm sure you're familiar with it, called Unselfied.
Yes.
That speaks exactly to the growing empathy gap that is being reported. So it seems like when we're talking about things of this magnitude, it's hard to come back to, you know, just learning to read. But that being said, you yourself said that literacy is what formed the basis of your career. And honestly, I come from a deep philosophy of education saves lives.
Yes.
And if without literacy, you are going to have a very difficult time learning to educate yourself.
Yes.
So that's how I'm going to swing us back around. So if a child has this sort of speech or language delay, do you see effects on that ultimately having a detrimental effect on learning to read?
Oh, considerably. This is such an issue. And we have so many children in our country that aren't where they should be with literacy. Any language problem is going to result in a literacy problem. Now here, I want to make that distinction between speech and language. Speech is just is the ability to make the sounds of your language. So being able, you know, to say the words, and you will have youngsters, some children are delayed in speech and it takes them longer to learn to say rabbit. They'll say wabbit, or they'll say thoop instead of soup. And some children can have problems with quite a number of sounds. Some of those children, the problem is just with the speech production, and their language can be okay. A number of them, however, have not only speech but language problems. But it's possible that children's speech is fine, but their language isn't where it should be. They don't have the vocabulary. They don't have the sentence complexity. And then as we look at development, you're first able to talk about what's in front of you. Then you can talk about something you can't see. That's where the narrative skills come in. And so you can have youngsters that sound fine when you're just talking to them face to face. But when you try to get them to tell a little story, they can't tell it coherently. And then you have to explain something. And that's more complex than telling a story. That's what I mean by language and increasing language complexity. And when children have language problems, that's going to have long-term effects on your reading ability. First, learning the decoding, that's the first step. That has to be there. And language problems will disrupt that ability to match the sounds to the print. But then once you can do that, you also have to understand how those sentences are constructed and what meaning is being conveyed.
And have that prior knowledge to sync the, you may be able to sound out a word, but if you only know what those sounds are and have no base level understanding of, you may be able to sound out the word apple and make sure it's an apple.
Right. But
if you've never eaten an apple, you don't really get the essence of what an apple is. So in talking about your, talking about the storytelling component it just goes right into, that's a key part of learning how to write effectively.
Yes.
As well. So, okay. So now we've taken listeners down kind of a rabbit hole of what can happen. And now we need to let's give some tools and best practices to help people if they recognize some of the patterns that are happening maybe in their own house or in loved ones' lives. And so what types of things can parents do to help lay the groundwork for speech development and language enrichment?
Oh, one of the foremost in what we were teaching the parents in Kuala Lumpur is how to reminisce with your child. This is one of the best ways to facilitate language development. By the time a youngster is around 18 months, they begin to give you a hint that they remember something that happened earlier. So let's say early in the day, your youngster got her fingers caught in the door and you put a Band-Aid on them. And later you see her going up and touching the door. And maybe she's just looking at her hand and looking, or maybe she'll say hurt her door. That gives you a cue. She remembers that she got her finger caught in the door. And you reminisce by saying, yes, you got your finger caught. It hurt. Mommy put a Band-Aid on your finger. That's reminiscing. It's through reminiscing that children learn to talk about past experiences. You're linking the present and you're linking the past. That's also eventually going to help the child be able to tell her own personal stories. So we're doing a tremendous amount of work with parents and teachers. Reminisce with your child. Look for those cues. Talk about the experience after it happened. With little ones, start right afterwards. So you just ate up that whole chocolate chip cookie. It's all gone. That is your favorite cookie. Talk about the event as you see the child doing it, but also afterwards. And as the children get older, there can be a longer period of time between the action and when you talk about it.
Okay. And I can absolutely see how that holds hands with attachment theory as well, because
Yes.
you're recognizing and validating prior experiences when you do things like that.
Turns out that promotes attachment. Moms who do
it.
more reminiscing have better attached children.
Oh, wow. Okay, so we know that technology is here to stay and kids are going to be interacting with screens. Can you go over how to use screens appropriately? Maybe talk about those, you and I had talked previously about pillars of quality
Right.
digital media content.
Right. Hirsch Pashuk has come up with this. Again, we're going to be dealing with screens. And when you're thinking about the apps to use, kind of keep four principles in mind. The first thing, that first pillar is it should be engaging and not distracting. Some apps for little kids are distracting, and some of them that read the stories to the children are the worst, because it'll have a children's storybook there and it will be reading it, but the child can tap the screen and the window opens and the drapes open and the rooster crows. And what I find kids doing, they're just tapping everything on the screen. They lose what the story was about. And on those kinds of books, comprehension is worse. So look for apps where you're not going to have things that pull the child away from what it is you're wanting them to attend to. The other thing, you want things that are where they're actively involved. And this is another problem with many of the apps for the little kids. They just hit, they just swipe. And you even see kids, you know, trying to swipe magazines because they think there's some way they should be able to make this thing work. So you want apps where the touch has to be specific. Don't just hit, don't just swipe. The interaction needs to be something meaningful. So when you tap, like there's a Grover story, there's a monster at the end of the book. And this is a really good little app, because on that one, Grover says, don't turn the page. And if you tap the corner of the page, it turns. That's functional. And Grover gets up, you turn the page. I told you, don't turn the page. So you're interacting with the book, promotes the story. So that's what you're wanting to look for, where the action is appropriate. It's not just hitting to make something magically appear. The next one, and particularly for little kids, choose apps and programs that are meaningful, something that they can relate to so that you can link it with their life. Now, clearly, as kids get older, one of the advantages of the internet, there's so much we can learn. But with little ones, you want to have some of that contact, things that they can connect with, so that what we do, what we call text to self. How is this like you? How is this something you do? And that's why, like some of the Peppa Pig or Dora the Explorer apps can be very appropriate, because they're experiences that the child has had, they can relate to them, you can add on. And the fourth pillar, particularly for the children under six, are apps where you can engage with the child. You can do them jointly. Even for older kids at times, playing the games with your children, but particularly with the children under six, they must be engaging. The children have to be actively involved. It has to be meaningful. And the parent needs to be mediating. And in fact, it turns out that if parents mediate those apps, you get a spike in language development. Oh. If you just leave the kid on their own, you don't. So there was one study that looked at what happens if parents engage. And so the app indeed can promote language development if the parent is sharing with the child during the experience.
So it needs to be a joint experience.
Yes.
Okay, we have to take a short break, but when I come back, I'm going to ask Carol Westby for her healthy screen habit.
Hi, I'm Amy Adams from Healthy Screen Habits. I have the privilege of running Book Club, and we invite you to join us each Friday over on Instagram at Healthy Screen Habits, where we discuss books that will help us create healthy screen habits for a balanced life. We have a book that we do every couple months, and we hope you'll join us and enjoy and learn and grow with us.
We are back. I'm talking with Carol Westby. On every episode of the Healthy Screen Habits podcast, I ask each guest for a healthy screen habit. This is a tip or takeaway that our listeners can put into practice in their own home. Carol, do you happen to have one that you can share with us today?
Well, again, we've kind of already mentioned this. It's finding apps where you can really become engaged and do the serve and return with the app. I like some of the Toca Boca apps for little ones because like there's the doctor one and you can take turns taking the splinter out of the character's finger or wiping its nose with the Kleenex. So activities with your youngsters under six where you can engage in this serve and return. We're taking turns within the activity and within the game. It can be appropriate even with the older children. I really encourage parents, play the game so you know what's in them, so that yes. You can talk meaningfully about the child. When I was doing the training at Kuala Lumpur, there was a little 10-year-old. He was playing really violent video games, and the parents hadn't noticed particularly. And they said, but it's okay. He says he knows the games are pretend, so it doesn't matter. And it's like, no, it really does. If you need to be on there, you need to see what he's looking at, because you also need to mediate. You need to talk about some of those things. With the older kids, Minecraft or the Horizons app that was the most popular app during COVID, which was a really nice one that both adults and kids were playing. You're doing daily activity kinds of things. You're making decisions. That's where, again, those apps can be really helpful when you're using them with the child in problem solving. What would you do? Why would you do it that way?
Right. Kind of taking that tech experience and bringing it forward into real life and living your thought process right. out loud. Carol, if people would like to read more about yourself or the Westby Play Scale or your research, is there someone they could go to look up your studies?
If you Google me, you can usually find me on Google. And I think there's some versions of the Play Scale floating around.
Oh, so, most definitely. all over the yeah. place.
So I think they can usually track me down.
Okay. Wonderful. Well, thank you very much for your time this morning and for all of the information.
Thanks so much for this opportunity, Hillary. I always enjoy talking about this.
For more information, you can find us on Instagram and Facebook at Healthy Screen Habits. Make sure to visit our website, healthyscreenhabits.org, where you can subscribe to the show on Apple Podcasts or via RSS so you'll never miss an episode. It's free, it's fun, and you get a healthy new screen habit each week. While you're at it, if you found value in this show, we'd appreciate you giving us a quick rating. It really does help other people find us and spread the word of Healthy Screen Habits. Or if you'd simply like to tell a friend, we'd love that too. I so appreciate you spending your time with me this week, and I look forward to learning more healthy habits together.